Hey, welcome to Speechless. We're live from the SCC studios in White Bear Lake. We're also playing live in St. Paul over SPNN. And we got a great show for you tonight. This is information you're going to want to know about because it's going to affect you, your children, your grandchildren, and in my opinion, the future of America. This is probably one of the most serious issues facing our country today. And it is being talked about in the press, but it is not raising to the level that it needs to be raised. And that's what's going on with our immigration policy. And why would I say that it's this serious? Well, you're gonna find out why it's this serious. But before we get into this show tonight, I want to talk about upcoming shows, but before we're going to talk about upcoming shows, I was reading, it came out in the paper today, you know, and you just read certain things on the internet, and this title caught my eye. Lawyer active in Winona area government lawsuits faces sanctions. So that title, this is out of the Winona Daily News, caught my attention. I said, something's going on here. Okay, who's this lawyer? And when I found out who it was, I wasn't surprised, but I'm highly disappointed in the U.S. Chief District Judge Michael Davis. When I heard his name being part of this, the judge who sanctioned this lawyer, I'm going, yeah, it doesn't surprise me at all. This is the modus operandi, the MO of this chief judge. And in the cases that I know that have gone before him, this, and especially against people trying to hold government officials accountable and especially judges accountable, he has sided against them in all the cases, and he's been overruled in a number of these cases. So, of course, these are my opinions. And so what had happened is Erick Kaardal, who you've seen videos, I've interviewed him. He's actually in the introduction of my show, speaking at a press conference. Filmed him being down at the legislature, speaking to the legislature. Anyway, what Chief Judge Michael Davis, he called the claims by lawyer Erick Kaardal, that's the lawyer, completely frivolous without a factual or legal basis. If anybody knows Erick Kaardal, he does not do that. He in no way does that. And so here's the chief judge, in my opinion, trying to flex his muscle and trying to smear this guy. Erick Kaardal was the lead judge in White versus the Minnesota Board on Judicial Standards, the Lawyers Responsibility Board, because Greg Wersel, an attorney running for the Minnesota Supreme Court, got Republican Party endorsement, and that was against the rules. Of course, free speech doesn't matter to our attorneys and to our judges, you know. So they lost, Erick Kaardal and Greg Wersel lost all the way up to the U.S. Supreme Court. And where they won 5-4. They didn't get one vote, just what I recall, and Greg Wersel was on the show, but Erick Kaardal was the attorney. And so here Davis has this opportunity, in my opinion, to go after Erick Kaardal, and he took it. And so evidently the sanctions, Davis ordered Kaardal to pay severe sanctions by reimbursing the attorney's fees and cost of the groups he sued. Of course, the article isn't specific. I'm going to talk to Erick. I'm going to find out more information, maybe have him on the show, who knows what. But this is just what I found out today. Could run up from $175,000 to $1 million. And, of course, Erick Kaardal is going to appeal that all the way through. And the judge ordered Kaardal to post a $200,000 bond, according to the Winona Daily News. Erick Kaardal had no comment. My personal opinion, without reading anything, so it probably shouldn't go any farther than that, I think this is payback, personally, because anybody knows Erick. He's not frivolous in what he does. So raises real issues and gets answers. And anyway, so, but on our upcoming shows, hopefully next week, there's been a lot of law changes regarding family law. And one of the persons in the study groups, and that Governor Dayton said, you 20 people, you 20 groups get together, whatever you agree on, I'll pass. That happened in the legislature. They were all passed. Session's over. All the bargaining's been done. We're going to have one of the persons, or maybe two or three of the people that were involved in this process, hopefully on next week. We'll see what happens there. But I think it's a fascinating process. And we thought this whole process was about reforming family law and getting parents involved in their kids' lives that are good parents. And it all turned out, most of it turned out to be about the money, okay, which is what the claims on the other side, that the side that wants families, good parents involved in their kids' lives, their claims from the other side was always it was about the money. Well, when it came to the ground where the parents wanted about the families, the other side wanted it about the money. You know, so it's just the game that goes on, and we're going to have that discussion. Also, the following week we'll have on Don Mashak, who was falsely accused of disorderly conduct in the courtroom and got acquitted, and we're going to tell that story because it just goes to show that police are willing to file false reports and exaggerate when they want and when they can and target people for whatever reason. And he was definitely a target, but he got acquitted on this. So, and then upcoming, if you've heard the show, Patterns of Evidence, about the Exodus, is a movie that came out. It was in the theaters across the nation, but select showings, about 350 theaters. We're going to have the producer and star of that show on. Their video's coming out, and they would like to be on the show to explain what took place. A local artist, a local filmmaker produced that, so we want to promote that. Besides the topic being very interesting, was there an exodus? Was the Israeli nation in Egypt? Did the Red Sea's part? What are the evidence? DVD is out now, and so you can order that, but let's get the people on and have our own discussion. You can call in and ask questions. And in that light, this is a live show, so you can call in at 651-747-3838 and ask questions of our guests and myself if you want. If you don't want, but to have comments, go to speechlessmn@gmail.com and give us your comments or observations about the show. I'd sure appreciate it. I eventually get to them. May take a couple months, but, you know, I eventually get to them. Okay, and then past shows, youtube.com/speechlessmn. You can see past shows on there. And today, my guest is AJ Kern, and she's a writer with the St. Cloud Writers? Nice. St. Cloud Times.
St. Cloud Times. I'm a Times writer.
Times writer. Mm-hmm. Okay. And this is a relatively new position for you, or?
Yes, I threw my hat in the ring when they had a opening, and now my column is the first Thursday of every month.
Okay. Well, you were on my show once before you got this job, mm-hmm. but I happened to be scanning the internet, and this particular subject on immigration came up, and you had an article, and I read that. And I started doing more research, and wow, all of a sudden, I mean, this is an important issue that's going on, right?
Yes.
I mean, that's how I saw it.
So
yes. We're going to talk about immigration, but mostly Muslim immigration or immigration from Muslim countries, right?
Otherwise, refugees.
Refugees.
Refugees,
okay.
Yes.
So in general, refugees. Okay. And you raised a number of concerns in your article. So, why don't you give us a little more of your background and why this topic interested you and what drew your attention to it?
Well, mainly because I live in the St. Cloud area, And I see that there's an impact, and it's being ignored. And so basically the way I look at it is that this is not a Republican thing, a Democrat thing. This is an American thing. This is an American issue. It's a human issue. And somehow our voice is being silenced and we're not able to talk about it. And so I wanted to focus on three major concerns. And the first one is taxation without representation.
Okay.
And I'll just go through these and explain what I'm talking about. One is our national security. And the third thing would be women's and children's issues. But on the taxation without representation, what we're seeing is that when you talk to state legislators and you ask them about it, I want to have some information. What is this costing? What's the impact on the schools, on our public services, et cetera? And they go, well, it's not my deal. It's not a state issue. Then you talk to federal people, and Emmer, I asked him during
Representative Emmer, yeah.
Yes, Tom Emmer. He was just, well, you know, did you send anything to my office? And he basically said, you know, this is a State Department issue, a U.S. State Department issue. So I wanted to talk about how the U.N. with this U.S. State Department are actually getting around the elected voice of the people and pulling this off with our tax dollars, because
okay.
they're using federal tax dollars to bring in the refugees and resettle them in our communities. And then we pick up the rest of the tab locally without having a voice.
Okay. So what I kind of hear you saying is that the UN is setting a policy for Minnesota. And is it through a treaty? Are they just doing it because they can't? Why is the UN saying, Minnesota, you have to do this and there's nothing you can do about it? I mean, is that what they're saying anyway? But
in cooperation with our own government, at the U.S. State Department is working with them, and they come up with a number and they decide, you know, how many the United States will take. And the State Department agrees, and then somehow they figure out which states
the refugees go
to. But I don't know how the UN, you know, how they have authority, but as you know, in many ways, we're losing more of our sovereignty over to the UN and a global kind of movement.
Right.
And this is just one of the ways that they're doing it.
Yeah, well, I mean, one thing I've talked about on the show quite a bit is the United Nations trying to take control over parents and parental rights in the United States through treaties. And those treaties can supersede our Constitution or define our Constitution. So that's why we have to be very careful about treaties with the United Nations, because it's more about a one government system telling us how to run things. And so do you see that happening here?
Yes. So what they do is they're using non-governmental organizations, or otherwise called VOLAGs. It's the voluntary agencies.
And non-government organizations, people hear the NGO. They hear that terminology.
NGO,
non-government organization. Mm-hmm. So what is a non-government organization?
Well, that's a good question. I don't know that I came with the exact definition.
Okay.
But they're just typically a nonprofit organization that is, you know, they get these grants so that they're processing, funneling tax dollars in order to accomplish some goal. So nationally, there's 9 of them. In Minnesota, we have 5. And I'll just say it real quickly. Catholic Charities, International Institute of Minnesota, Arrive Ministries, which is formerly World Relief, Minnesota Council of Churches, and Lutheran Social Services. And the thing is they're de facto government bureaucracies that hinder transparency and accountability to the people.
Right, and how, I mean, that's surprising to me.
it is surprising.
You know, that something shocking, would be set up, really. But what? How do they hinder accountability and transparency? How does that happen? Just so you can't find out information?
They are not subject to public data laws.
So you have organizations that are getting lots of money from the federal government.
Yes.
And you can't go and do a data practice request on them.
No. You can see their tax returns, but you cannot see the details. Let me give you an example.
Because they're a charity? Because they're... I don't understand that. So what?
Well, you cannot submit a FOIA, a Freedom of Information
right.
Act data request. I mean, it doesn't
they
apply.
They just won't.
They're not government.
Okay.
Okay. So in 2013, Lutheran Social Services received over $82 million in federal taxpayer funds. And they... there's different numbers. I have 585. I have a different sheet here that actually says that in 2013 they resettled 2,214 in Minnesota, 2,232 in the year 2014.
Mm-hmm.
Or maybe that's national. It gets confusing. See, that's the problem. It gets confusing. Others say 579. Refugees. But it gets confusing because of the second wave of immigration, and we'll get to that in just a minute. But the point is that in 2014, mm-hmm. Lutheran Social Services received $91 million, and Catholic Charities received over $20 million. And we
have some graphics on this, so you can put those graphics up every once in a while, and just put them full screen so people can see them while we talk about them.
But if you have $82 million and you're resettling 585 refugees in the state of Minnesota, that's about as far as you go. I mean, you don't see the details. If that $82 million went to all those refugees, they should be living pretty well. But that's actually not the case. We're actually paying CEOs higher, but we'll get to that in a minute here.
That's a tremendous amount of money. But no details. I wonder, you know, because the Minnesota data practices doesn't apply to our judicial branch. There's a different law. So I'm wondering if there's a different law that allows you to get that information, but I can see where, because they're a private charity, you don't get that, even if it is government funded.
They are not subject to public data laws, period. And in fact, yesterday I attended a meeting held by Lutheran Social Services. They're supposed to have quarterly meetings that involve stakeholders. Well, apparently the public are not stakeholders.
Right. I've seen that over and over down at the legislature. Public are not stakeholders. And I deal a lot with family law stuff, and fathers are not stakeholders. You know, even though they're going to do all this regulation around fathers, they're not stakeholders, you know.
Right.
It's just amazing. They get left out of the picture purposefully. It's interesting to say. But so you as an individual, even though these laws affect you, you don't get a say.
Exactly. And that's why I guess I'm speaking up about this, because we're seeing taxation without representation,
mm-hmm.
and I think we've fought a revolutionary war over that issue.
Right.
And so here we are again, where the government is figuring out how to circumvent the people. You know, it's the same with the Common Core. How does the federal government take over it under the guise of, it was state-led. It was not state-led, but
no.
we're going to go with these themes that are not truthful.
Right.
And circumvent the voice of the people. And here we have it, another example with the refugee resettlement. So we have this closed meeting, no public, but it was held in a public building, the county building. There were police officers there. So we're paying for it,
mm-hmm.
but we don't have any say. So the people who sat at the big table All those agencies represented all have their hand in the money pot. There are hundreds of organizations that have their hand in the money pot. This is an entrenched machine here. Mm-hmm. It's an entrenched industry that's completely out of control.
So how many groups would you say were at the table? This is at a meeting in St. Cloud, right? How many groups were at the table?
There's quite a long list.
I mean,
I would say about 20. 20 okay. were represented, maybe. I'd say roughly that.
Well, I mean, I'm trying to draw this comparison because you look at a city council meeting like Maplewood, and you got your city council that doesn't make a whole lot of money because of the way they're structured, but all the staff there are making over $100,000. You know, there's well over $1 million of salary, or very close to it, sitting in that room. So you got a lot of money sitting for these organizations that are just for the people that are there representing them as stakeholders. A lot of money sitting at that table, and they get that money basically by the federal government.
Yes.
A majority of it.
Yes.
So
yes.
Do they care who comes into the United States or not?
The organizations like Lutheran Social
yeah.
Services? I don't think they're really paying attention who's who.
Okay.
All they're concerned about is head counting and keeping the same number up so that they maintain their budget.
Okay.
So what it looks like is that right now Lutheran Social Services receives about 89% of its budget from the federal government.
89%?
Yes. So became a powerhouse when this little sweet deal started about.
Mm-hmm.
They weren't before, and now they have administrators. And here's the crazy part. I mean, I didn't know people were supposed to be getting very wealthy over this, but the CEO, Jody Harpstead,
mm-hmm.
Here's just a snapshot of one of their tax returns right here. I think this is an older one, so it's an older one, so it's close to $300,000. But I think today, with benefits and everything, I think her whole package is closer to like $400,000.
Mm-hmm.
$400,000. I mean, it's and so all the administrators are making pretty darn good money.
Mm-hmm.
They've got to keep this going, and
yeah.
it's not about right and wrong or they just need to keep the people and the voice, the people who are asking questions at bay. And then it's when it comes to the second wave of migration. So they bring in their number of 215 is what they're claiming for the St. Cloud area. So statewide, I'm not sure what it was this year, but they bring in 215 and they claim that it's all family reunification, although they can't prove it. And then they did admit that a large number of those coming in now our second migration, and they have no control over it. They say, we have no idea what the numbers are, but it's that a refugee would come from Somalia and they go into another state like Wyoming,
mm-hmm.
and then they realize that they'll get better benefits in Minnesota, and there's growing communities of Somalian people.
Right.
So this is where they want to come, and nobody's really keeping track of it. So when you go to the county, the human services, it's like pulling teeth trying to get that information, and I think it's going to take, you know, the Minnesota data request to actually get some of these things answered, because some ladies had gone and asked, and they left without any answers.
They wouldn't. No, nobody would. The charities wouldn't give them any
the
answers.
The charities don't really, and neither has the government yet. I mean,
the charity shouldn't have a restriction on them. I don't think there's nothing that says they can't tell you numbers. I would think that. Maybe the government puts that on them, but then they would be subject to data practices. The government's telling. I mean, this is how bad and mismanaged this is going to be. Just before we get back into the how all these extra refugees come into town. When you're talking about the administrators, how much money they make, it's what I call no administrator left behind.
Exactly.
There's no child left behind, but it's really about the administrators, yeah. Making sure they get more administrators, more jobs. And that's what I see going on here with the refugee thing is we have to have a certain number of refugees. We've got to keep it at coming in order to get more money, in order to keep our jobs. And who cares about United States, who cares about our culture, who cares about our liberties, who cares about what these people will do to our country?
Right, and that's not even a concern. This is such an entrenched industry, and there are so many organizations and people that have their hand in the money pot. They have a self-interest to keep it going, whether it's right or wrong. And one way to ward off the masses is to keep them uneducated about the truth.
Mm-hmm.
And that is exactly what we're seeing here. And, you know, when you look at, dig a little bit deeper, and you see that the refugees are being brought in, they're brought into these apartment buildings, and they're giving subsistence living. That's got to be a struggle. But then they're getting jobs with Hormel and Jennie-O and Golden Plump, and you know, it begs the question, are we actually engaging in legal human trafficking? Because if we weren't bringing them in, and these companies actually had to raise the minimum wage a little bit, like some complain they want,
right?
Maybe they would have to raise it just, you know,
naturally in order to get the labor force.
In a capitalist system.
Right.
To fill those positions that would help people actually live, earn a living, and but what we're doing is using the government is funding cheaper labor,
mm-hmm.
And so then you have some people arguing that this is good for them. I don't know. It's having other impacts that on our community that people are asked actually some of it's out there that. I wanted to get to that the legitimate questions are and the impacts and the costs that people are struggling to have. You know, they're concerned about their community. Their grandparents were there, their parents, they're having their families there, and they see that the schools, like in St. Cloud, they have about 3 million for English language learners. And I know in St. Paul, isn't it more like, I've read somewhere, I think it was around 20 million. What happened to the achievement gap? I mean, we were talking about the achievement gap with the kids that we have here.
Right.
And now we've brought in this issue that's no small issue for teachers and the whole educational system.
Right.
I mean, this is just slamming, and nobody's really wanting to talk about it except for that we need to build washrooms, you know. The thing I will say is if people
aren't
paying attention.
That's so counter our culture, and which is creating such a big expense, and we're having to bring in more teachers to deal with this issue, and there is no economic gain in this situation. It's all cost. These are people or groups of people who are not going to integrate into our society. Their culture is so anti- United States society, they're not producing right now.
Right? Not yet. I mean, there's a claim that it'll catch up, that they'll catch up on some level. But a little bit of what I wrote about in my article is that what we're seeing is there's even with the president, the policy mm-hmm. is no longer, they don't even use the word assimilation any longer.
Mm-hmm.
It's integration. They're integrating, and we have to accommodate.
Okay.
And so that's the reality.
All right.
So the lack of assimilating is creating a lot of conflict.
So they're not assimilating like... These refugees aren't assimilating like they're expected to assimilate.
Not like traditional people who have come here and they want to become American. Mm-hmm. I mean, I think now the thought is that they're going to move here and they're going to retain their culture and all the things that they do, even though we haven't accommodated other cultures. people wanted to become American. And we have an American culture. And so this is naturally going to create a conflict. And
so what else is it doing to St. Cloud in this case? That's where you're...
Well, the legitimate questions are is that we can see that rental occupied housing has risen over 66%, you know, rather than family-owned homes and that kind of thing. The rental market is going up. The rate of poverty has increased by 23%. So I'm sure this is happening more in the hot spots, you know, Wilmer, in the cities, the rate of poverty is going to go up when you have more people coming here in great numbers, you know, and adding to those that we were already trying to help. But there's so many unknowns, you know, unknown healthcare services. What's that impact? And the city and county services, I mean, we don't know. And even if that information is out there, it's very difficult to get to. And again, we don't have our state voice, elected voice, saying, you know what, we need to find out what the impact is on our communities, and we don't have our federal voice speaking for, you know, trying to help us out. So
it's just kind of being ignored. This is just something that's happened. Refugees is something we've always done, but now there's a new wrinkle. But we're going to avoid that wrinkle and not discuss
it. I think they're afraid to. And I think the reality is that there are a lot of citizens who would just like basic answers. And what are the numbers? And tell me how we're going to deal with it. How are we going to help our schools when our teachers have maybe two kids who can't speak English and they're thrown into a certain grade level because of their age? Maybe they should be in a separate class until they can speak English appropriately, you know, efficiently. And maybe put in with younger ages until they catch up. I don't know what the answers are, but we're not even talking about it.
Yeah.
You can't solve it if you can't talk about
it. Right, exactly. And the teachers, St. Paul School Board, are they talking about it? I don't think they are publicly.
I don't think they feel like they can. But I do know in one of the schools in St. Cloud, I mean, the teachers are leaving a certain school, so they're working. I mean, I think they're bringing in younger teachers or newer teachers or something. But there are teachers who are along the line where they can ask, they have seniority to ask for a transfer, maybe early retirement. I don't know, but there was something in the paper about that not too long ago. So
you have the school problem. But you also have the housing problem, not only of finding places for people to live. So these are really decreasing the available space for public housing and increasing the need for more public housing. But what's happening to the facilities that they're living in? My understanding from what I was reading is that things are being destroyed. They're still living in their culture. They don't know how to live with the amenities that we have, and where they used to live, they can do certain things that you can't do here, but they're still living as if they were in their other country. So what are some of those stories?
That's another thing. Let's just ignore it and hope it goes away. Let's hope they just figure it out. It doesn't always work that way, but what was interesting is at this closed meeting yesterday, there were a couple of ladies there who are property managers. I was kind of surprised that they were actually honest about some of the issues that they deal with. The one lady said that they had to keep replacing the vinyl in one apartment because they kept flooding the floor. They keep having to go back because the toilets are, toys are in there and they don't know how to use a plunger. I'm not sure what all the deal is, but in one apartment, the little boy keeps jumping on the dishwasher door, so they've had to replace the door three times. So there's damage going on. They don't understand about maintenance, I guess, or even calling to get maintenance. And then they say there's a language barrier, like they have a notebook with photos of the refrigerator and the stove or whatever it is, so that they can come in and point to what's not working. So it's Well, it's a challenge. And they were complaining that they want 4, 5, and 6-bedroom apartments.
Okay.
Because the occupancy, there's over-occupancy. They said there could be like 15 to 30 people for some apartments that just are flowing through. Now, once a family rents an apartment, they're supposed to know who is in the apartment.
Mm-hmm.
But what's happening is that they have people, family members or friends coming from out of state.
Mm-hmm.
They come into St. Cloud, and then they're in the apartment. So there's too many people in the apartment,
mm-hmm.
and the management can't keep track of who's who. So there's some violations
right.
on that end, which, you know, what do you do?
Yeah. Well, the other thing I heard some about the farming that's going, the ranching that's going on there. These apartments are turning into chicken ranches or something. Putting chickens in the cupboards and
I've heard that. I think that there's a hesitation for apartment management or other individuals that have actually gone in and seen some situations to actually talk about it. I think people have a real fear of being labeled. You know, if you kind of point things out that there are issues. So it's
well, labeled or backlash, or both.
Both, maybe both. Are
some of these apartment managers getting backlash?
I don't know. I haven't actually talked to them personally.
Okay.
I can't remember if I told you that they also said that 95% of the Somalis that come into the United States want to come to Minnesota.
Hmm.
That's what they said at this meeting, which I thought was very interesting.
Did they give a reason why?
Not really. I think it's the benefits, and I think it's that maybe they already know someone who's here.
Okay.
And that the community is growing here.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you don't want to go maybe to Martha's Vineyard if they don't have a Somali community growing
right.
there.
Right, yeah.
You want to go where it exists. So anyway...
Well, okay, so we talked about schools, property, healthcare services. I mean, that was one of the issues you raised, and that has been raised, is do they take care of themselves? Do they know what to do? Who's picking up this cost, and is it a significant cost?
I know the taxpayer does for a while, but I don't know what the limitations are. I don't know what the terms are. I don't know how long. But I did read in some of the paperwork they gave us that a lot of them are, because there's some complications in getting onto the programs, that they do end up going much of the time to the emergency room. So we know that can be an issue when a lot of folks start showing up at the emergency room instead of you know, the other care, there's like urgent care type of facilities, but it's going to cause the cost to go up, I
mm-hmm.
would guess, because then the taxpayers are covering those costs.
Mm-hmm.
But it's difficult to just walk over to the hospital and find out, hey, you know, can you tell me what these, you know, what the costs are, and how many people are you seeing, that refugees are, that you're seeing each month, and
mm-hmm.
what are the average costs? I mean, again, I don't know if they would make that information readily available or not, but.
Well, this is becoming a big expense, and at least from what I read in your article and others, is that it's stressing St. Cloud and their
mm-hmm.
county services
mm-hmm.
and the state services. That
right.
it's just overwhelming.
Yep.
It.
And I talked to a gentleman at the meeting yesterday. He was from Wilmer, and he said the same thing is happening in Wilmer.
Mm-hmm.
So I guess when they come into the state, if something doesn't work out in the cities for them, then they go to these other satellite type of communities where they may have people to help them figure out where the county offices are, or
mm-hmm.
who they can live with temporarily. So
who's picking up the costs? I mean, these Lutheran social services, obviously, and these other organizations are getting money from the federal government. But that does that cover everything? Does it cover all their expenses? Is some of this going on to the county and the city?
I don't know. I don't know. I know it's limited. What Lutheran Social Services does for them, they get a certain amount of money per person. They get them on track for trying to find a job, trying to find housing, trying to find household goods, and at some point, you're on your own.
Mm-hmm.
You know, here's where the county office is, and you sign up for your Social Security card and whatever other benefits that you're eligible for.
Mm-hmm.
And after that, there's just a lot of unanswered questions, and you know, what is it costing the local government? What's it costing the county? We don't know exactly.
Yeah, it's somebody knows. Somebody has all the pieces put together, and obviously these NGOs or voluntary agencies, they know. They know how they make their money, and that's all they're concerned with. But there's just a lot of angles in there, but we don't know.
Right, and my understanding too is that there's organizations like the Blandin Foundation, McKnight Foundation, the Initiative Foundation. They're all involved in this too.
Okay.
So I haven't dug that deep yet.
So we don't know what aspect they're involved
but
with.
I think they're assisting in getting the grants, training people. You know, so many organizations have some benefit here that they're going to work real hard to keep all the information from the people, and they want to keep it going because they're making big bucks.
Yeah. One thing I don't understand, and it seems a little, it really seems weird, and really this was what bothers me the most, is that certain refugees are coming from countries, and the reason they're coming is because of war. They're being persecuted, okay, for whatever reason, typically a religious persecution of some sort. But it's the same religion that is persecuting. So you got refugees that, but there's whole nations that are established around those religions. So why aren't these refugees that are being persecuted by one country go to another country where their religion is accepted? Why isn't the UN putting these people over there? And of course, then you have those states, nation states, that are persecuting the other end of their religion. And so those refugees, why aren't they going over to the other nation? You know, and why aren't they taking care of each other? Why are they coming here?
Well, that's very complicated, isn't it?
Well, it is.
We have a...
It doesn't make any sense.
A
Why?
A kettle of fish we have, right?
Yeah.
I guess first just security issues. That was going to be one of my second concern. I'll get to the whole dynamic of the culture and the religion in just a second, but... I wanted to point out that the committee chair, Congressman McCall, he's the committee chair for the Homeland Security, and he's now raising concerns, and he's saying that admitting Syrians, which is who they want to bring in now, it's very dangerous, and because you can't really vet them, you can't really do a background check, and I'm thinking, well, you couldn't really do a background check on people from Somalia or Kenya or some of these Iraq or some of these other countries. Who do you call? I mean, you really aren't. But now we have someone at the federal level who is saying, hey, you know, I hope he sticks on this a little bit harder, because now we have Amy Klobuchar and Al Franken who want to welcome in thousands of Syrians into our state now, when we're already saying, you know, you guys aren't the voice for the local community. Mm-hmm. You're not paying attention to the impact. You're dropping them off, and then you're saying, there you go. And then the people are expected to just ignore the man behind the curtain kind of thing. We're in the land of Oz where you're just supposed to deal with it.
But these Syrians are not, they are anti-American. They are against everything that we stand for.
Well, that's right, because they do have a different religion, a different culture, and they don't separate their religion from their government like mm-hmm. we do. So that's going to cause some conflict. I was looking at this article that was written by a man from Somalia, and he was talking about that they've had decades of conflict mm-hmm. and that they're clans. Mm-hmm. Now, before, when we brought in refugees,
why don't you bring that article up on the screen? Or do you want it?
It's right there.
But they can't see it.
But he's talking about that there's clans, and the clans fight, and they're all the same culture and the same, you know, they're all Muslim. Sunni, Shia, they have fought forever. We can't solve that problem. Now the clans, they come over here, who's who? So we have some over here, and
this
should be a concern for them, because now you're seeing new names come, mm-hmm. and are they going to start fighting here? Which is the next slide, is now in Fargo, they're reporting that immigrant groups are battling it out in the streets of Fargo.
Wow.
So I know we're kind of limited on time, but... I did want to get in real quick before we're done, the women's issues. And
sure.
Because
well, let's take a quick phone call here. We got a call, and we got little time left, and this is probably this is a big issue coming up here. But caller, you have a comment or question?
Yes. Some of your questions that you have of how we got involved with this immigrant policy actually mm-hmm. originated in the Congress passed the Refugee Act of 1980,
okay.
and it was an agreement through a treaty with several countries of the UN, how this all first got started. And also, if you'd like to know the number of refugees coming to Minnesota, the best reference point is the Minnesota Department of Health, and you can go to www.health.state.mn.us/refugee, and it actually breaks down the number of primary refugees going to each county with the country of their origin, and it also tracks the secondary refugees arrivals. So that would help if you want to get more information.
That's awesome.
I appreciate that, and if you can email me that link, I'll watch the show again, but if you can just email me that link there, I'd appreciate it. It'd be easier for me.
Sure, okay.
But I appreciate that.
Yep, you're welcome.
Yeah, that's great information.
Yeah, and I figure there probably had to be some kind of treaty that allowed this to happen. Mm-hmm. But 1980, that was a different world.
Yes, it's changing.
And the impact of that now is pretty serious. But let's get into this woman and child issue.
Yeah, I wanted to, really quick, because this is so critical that, you know, Muslim-dominant countries are not democracies, and Islamic law is Sharia law. And, you know, as a woman, I am so concerned about this, because women have fought for equality for so long, and now here we are bringing in a culture that, you know, the woman's right is limited, and you could see this. It's not that difficult. And I lived in Iran when I was a teenager. I know what I'm talking about. Women are not equal. They don't have the voice of men. In Islamic culture, the man owns all the property. The women are subservient. There's really no minimum age specific to females for marriage. And I wanted to put in here the female genital mutilation. Why is it no one's talking about this? It's a taboo topic. And yet, there
was... standard practice?
It's, I mean, 98% of Somali women were reported to have some form of female genital mutilation in a Phoenix refugee women's clinic. That is happening here. They don't just get off the airplane and stop engaging in this part of their culture now. Yeah. Who's making the decision that we embrace your culture, but oh, there's certain things in your culture we're not embracing, we're not having the conversation, and who would be making these decisions anyway? And so I'm just concerned that this is a culture that, you know, for the ages of 4 to 11 for girls, that their mothers, their grandmothers hold these little girls down. These little girls who look to the very people that love them.
Mm-hmm.
And they cut their genitals off without any anesthesia or anything. And sometimes they're stitching up their vaginas. And we aren't even talking about it. We're not protecting them. And I'm sure that there's medical people that are seeing this, and yet we're not hearing a thing about it.
Yeah.
So,
That's against the law in the United States, isn't it?
It is, but there's a lot of things against the law.
Sure.
And I'm worried that one little girl is going to suffer that here. I'm sure
so
that
it's not being enforced here. Or the authorities don't know about it.
I'm pretty sure the authorities know about it. But the thing is it's just like everything else. It's difficult information to find out. Is it happening here? I've heard people say that they were actually aware of something happening, a little girl going to the hospital. But I don't know. It's all so... You know, are the hospitals required to report it? And if they are, is it public information? I mean, we aren't even talking about it. I'm really just not able to grasp that they would be getting on an airplane, changing their geographical location, and just saying, well, we're not going to engage in this thing where almost 100% of the Somalis have had it. And there's a 2013 report that said, this is a Population Reference Bureau, up to 507,000 U.S. women and girls had undergone female genital mutilation or were at risk.
Mm-hmm.
Wow.
So how does all this change? I mean...
We need leadership. We need Tom Emmer to...
Say something.
Something towards us. Amy Klobuchar, Al Franken. You know,
to me, that's the real, who's being silent in these things, is Amy Klobuchar. She's just covering, she knows this. She's not naive. She's as smart as she says she is. She knows what's going on. She knows this is happening, and she won't talk about it. She's just covering it up. You know, this is serious stuff. This is bad. There's a reason our country exists. It's to stop things like this. That's why we're a country. I mean, it's just
freedom,
outrageous.
Liberty, and to protect the weak and to protect those that can't.
Right.
And in the meantime, we aren't even having the discussion, and we don't have the leadership that's answering the questions and being the voice of the people that put them there.
It's just not the mutilation issue, even though how terrible that is and how drastic that is, it's all things combined. This is so anti-feminism.
Yep.
And they won't say a word.
That's right.
You know.
And the women need to wake up and realize that, you know, I've dealt with, what woman hasn't dealt with chauvinism in their life? You know,
right.
You do. But I don't embrace this culture that I've actually lived in a Muslim-dominant mm-hmm. culture, and I'm not going to embrace it. I want to have equal rights. I want to have free speech. And I don't want little girls in danger of having their genitals cut off.
Yeah, yeah. Well, got about 30 seconds here. So any last thoughts on all this? I find this fascinating.
And, I would like to see people contact their state legislators and say, you know what, this is your issue.
Mm-hmm.
We need a moratorium until we have more answers on the impact of our society. The people need to contact their federal representatives and say, you know, you better get on board with finding some answers for us, because that's what we elected you for.
Right.
To speak for us. And
Well, thank you, AJ Kern. I appreciate it, you coming on and giving us this information. And let's just go to camera 3 here. I There's a somewhat related to this, but I'm going to come up and do a show here in the next couple weeks too, that talks about Islam, the Islam culture, how it's affecting the United States, and to me, it's scary. And I think there's a lot of information that we as Americans, we don't know that culture well. We don't know how it's, what they think, how they think. And I've been doing a lot of studying on Islam, the Muslim culture, and I'm going to do a show on it, and I think it's just going to be wake you up that we need to change our policies at the federal level, and we need to look how it's going to affect our children and our grandchildren if we continue on as a country doing the things we're doing and not understanding what's going on in the Middle East. So that'll be an upcoming show, and you know, in my opinion, the United States is in a bad spot right now, and it's going to get worse unless we do something. All right, thanks for watching. Remember, if you don't stand for other people's liberties, who's going to stand up for yours? And good men don't do nothing. God bless. Have a great week.